mercy never fail me. In all my days, I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Yeah. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Yeah. chain. By the close of day, you welcome to the town power auditorium. A man that wanted to casting it at a sovereign tide. Oh, island in the sun, were to be by my father's hand. On my knees, I will sing the praise of your forest, waters of shining sun. Oh, island in the sun. Word to me by my father's hand. All my days I will sing the praise of your forest, waters of shining sun. Oh yeah. Sun shines daily on the mountain top. I took a train on a sailing ship. When I reached Jamaica, I made a stop. But I'm sad to say I'm on my way. I'll be back for many days. My heart is down, my heart is turning around. Got to leave a little girl in Kingston town. But I'm I'm on my way. I will be back for many a day. My heart is down, my heart is sitting around. Got to leave a little girl in Kingston town. Of laughter everywhere when the sun shines daily in the bobbing hole. I took a trip on a sailing ship. When I reach Jamaica, I made a stop. But I'm sad to say I'm on my way. I won't be back for many days. My heart is down, my heart is sitting wrong. Got to leave a little girl in Kingston town. But I'm sad to say I'm on my way. I won't be back for many days. My heart is down, my heart is sitting around. Got to leave a little girl in Kingston town. Oh yeah. Days. My heart is down, my
Dr. Arthur, and with us his overview on the public lecture today. As earlier said, we are marking the fourth annual Nathan Anankwao Excellence Awards 2021 here at the CLOCSAG National Headquarters. And we're bringing you live coverage on CLOCSAG TV with me, Anoko Ado. Stay tuned.
around the world I've searched for you. I've traveled on when hope was gone to keep a rendezvous. I knew sometime
bring you life coverage of the fourth annual Nathan Anankwal Excellence Awards 2021. Today marking the commencement of the two-day awards ceremony. Today is the public lecture, and we have Professor Joseph Achuaye doing us the honor to deliver today's public lecture from the University of Ghana. University of Ghana, and he is a professor of political science. Mr. Kwal, while in service, he displayed a varying key values as part of his duties. He discharged professionalism, selflessness, integrity, among others. These key values he displayed made him serve under different political regimes. And as part of CLOSAG's neutrality project, we are here today to mark the Nathan Anankwal Excellence Awards, where it seeks to instill or reiterate to CLOSAG members the need to remain neutrality while in service, as well as honor CLOSAG members who have over the years been dedicated in discharging their duties with professionalism, integrity, selflessness, loyalty, among others. So as we are here, we'll be having engagements with some key people as they come in. We'll interview them to give us an overview of their expectations of today's public lecture. As Nathan Anankwal once posits, that it is the perfection of the civil servant that will move this country forward, and not the politician. We are here to give honor to whom honor is due. Stay tuned, CLOSAG TV, Anoko Ado reporting live. I've searched for you. I've traveled on when hope was gone to keep a rendezvous. I knew sometime, somewhere, when you look at me and you will see a smile, you're smiling now. It might have been County down, all in New York, in Gay Paris, or even London town. No more will I go around the world, for I find my heart in you. Around the world for you, I've traveled on when hope was gone to keep a rendezvous. I knew sometime, somewhere, and you will see that you will know the smile, and smile, you're smiling now. It might have been in County Down, all in New York, in Gay Paris, or even London town. No more will I go around the world, for I've set my heart in you.
open for you. You are welcome to Nathan Carl Auditorium. Around the world, I've sent for you. I've traveled on when hope was gone to keep a rendezvous. And you, sometime, somewhere, somehow, when you look at me and you will see the smile you're smiling now. It might have been in Canada, all in New York, in Gaffery, or even London town. No more will I go around the world, for I've found my love in you. Girl of my dreams, I love you. Unless I do, you are so sweet. And if I could hold your chance again in my arms, then life would be complete. Girl of my dreams, I love you. Unless I do, you are so sweet. If I could hold your hand again in my arms, then life will be complete. Since you've been gone, dear, life seems the same. And you know that I love you, baby, you know I do. Now the whole said and done, you are the only one. Girl of my dreams, you. This one is cool and suffering realization. Yeah. Girl of my dreams, I love you. Unless I do, you are so sweet. If I could hold your chance again in my arms, girl of my dream, it's you. Girl of my dreams, I love you. Unless I do, you are so sweet. If I could hold your chance again in my arms, girl of my dreams, it's you. Since you've been gone, dear, life seems the same. You know that, baby, no, I do, I do. If I could hold your chance again in my arms, can lock my dreams, it's you. Fly me to the moon, let me play among the stars. Let me see what's praise. It's like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand, darling. In other words, darling, kiss me. So, fill my heart with songs.
Hello, hello.
Let me sing forevermore.
Hello. Hello.
And you are all I long for. And I worship and adore. In other words, please be true.
Good morning. The head of local government services, Engineer Dr. Nana Atuwata, the chief director of the office of the head of civil services, Dr. Jay Brock, who's representing the head of civil services, the chief director of the Ministry of Sanitation and Water Resources, Mr. Noah Tumfu, chief director of the local government services, Office of the Local Government Services, Mr. James Opon Mensa, Professor Joseph Achu Aye of the University of Ghana, the National Executive Council of CLOCSAG, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, and respected colleagues of the Fourth Estate. My name is Emmanuel L. Ankra, and on behalf of the Civil and Local Government Staff Association of Ghana, CLOCSAG, I have the honor to welcome you to the fourth Nathan Anankwao Annual Lecture and Awards 2021. This is the fourth in the series, and this year we split the event into two, as you may have observed. 2 days, actually. So for day one, which is today, we're having the lecture and a very hearty interaction. And then day two, that is tomorrow, we'll have the Excellence Awards. We're supposed to be following COVID protocols, which includes not getting confined in a particular space for too long a duration. Now, this is the fourth, as I said earlier, and the first edition was held in 2018. The theme was upholding integrity in the public service. The second edition was in 2019, enhancing political neutrality in the civil and local government services, the role of the politician. The third edition was 2020, even during the COVID crisis. It was on the theme, neutrality in the civil and local government services, a reality or mirage. This year, the theme is neutrality in local governance, nonpartisan election of MMDCEs. So as you may observe, it goes through a kind of romantic but Tom and Jerry kind of relationship between the civil and local government worker and the politician. This year, we'll take it even deeper. And there will be a lecture, and then we'll open the floor for questions and contributions. But we can't start without calling upon the Lord. As usual, we start with an opening prayer. And the one who's been doing it for us is at it again. Please, let's welcome Pastor Bayo.
Good morning. May I please crave your indulgence? Let's rise to our feet as we pray. Blessed are you, O Lord, sustainer and defender of our lives. We give you praise and we thank you for this privilege today. We ask that your spirit would aid us and help us throughout this activity today. We receive your grace. We declare that it will be a joyous moment in the name of Jesus. We commit the rest of the agenda into your hands. take preeminence and let it be a glorious one. Thank you, because we know we have received what we have asked in Jesus' name. Amen. Please take your seat.
Is the Chief Director of the Ministry of Parliamentary Affairs, Professor Evans Agredakun. Thanks for coming. So I kind of gave you a brief overview of what these events are about, the awards and the lectures. But then we have to get a deeper perspective of it all. And so we'd like to invite CLOCSAG itself to come and give us that insight. To do that is the Executive Secretary of CLOCSAG. Please welcome Mr. Isaac Bampo Addo.
Hello. Thank you, Blaobi L. Ankara. I'm supposed to give a welcome address. As for the head of local government service, first and foremost, the Holy Spirit before the head of local government service. The head of local government service, Chief Director, Office of the Head of Civil Service, Chief Director, Local Government Service, Chief Director, Parliamentary Affairs, members of CLOCSAG, Blaobi assembled. Because when I say Blaobi, because Itankwa was a student, a school prefect, and a teacher at Accra Academy. So we are proud of Itankwa. It's not only CLOCSAG. Friends of the media, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the fourth edition of the Nathan Anankwa Awards scheme has brought us together once again. It is worthy to note that the Nathan Anankwa Awards was instituted in 2017 by the Civil and Local Government Staff Association, CLOCSAG, for both staff in active service and on retirement within the civil service and the local government service. Its main objective is to motivate the staff within the services to strive for integrity, excellence, professionalism, transparency, and that loyalty in anonymity pays. In as much as it takes the profession of the civil service to move the country forward, and not the politician, ascribed to the late Nathan Anankwa, CLOCSAG continues to sponsor this annual event in order to sustain the idea of profession in the civil service as well as the local government service. On the basis of these principles, some civil servants will be honored. For those whom the searchlight has not shone on them yet, the opportunity is there in subsequent years. For those who will be rewarded, we say congratulations and Ayiko. On behalf of the National Executive Council, the National Executive Committee of CLOCSAG, I warmly welcome you to this event. Enjoy the day. Thank you all. God bless you. You see, it's an effective civil service. An effective civil service is essential to a modern day democratic society. And a measure of neutrality is necessary for this profession to preserve this effectiveness. We want to state a few things that we have a situation where, as of now, some councils have been inaugurated and established, but the pivot which is the Civil Service Council and the local government councils, are yet to be established. And we think these are the first councils that should have been established. Because for it's an effective civil service that will move this country forward. The second issue is we've gone to the Supreme Court. We've had our ruling. It is very clear. No civil servant, when you say a civil servant, is both in central service and decentralized service. No civil servant can be an assemblyman and at the same time be a civil servant. You must resign. But it's come to our notice that government, it says no civil servant should be an assemblyman. So whether elective or appointive is a civil, is a, it cannot be an assemblyman unless you have to resign. But government is appointing civil servants as assemblymen. This is a contradiction, and it's contempt to the ruling of the Supreme Court. So I hope there are some government officials here. Please be advised before Closac takes under action. Thank you.
Okay, so the Executive Secretary of Closac has set the tone. Then there are some statements from the two services. So we'd like to respectfully invite first Engineer Nana Atuwata, head of the local government services, to give the statement. A big round of applause for him, please.
The rep of the head of the civil service, my reverse heightmate, Nana Rexusuansa, former chairman, local government service council, chief directors here present, executive secretary Closac and your team, Prof. Achuaye, my big brother, the our guest speaker, distinguished members of Closac, the media, ladies and gentlemen. I thought we were going to go by the program because Nana was to give the first brief statement, but it has fallen the second Nana, so I accept it. I bring you very warm greetings from the local government service. And I must express my genuine appreciation to the executives of the Civil and Local Government Staff Association, CLOSAG, for their extraordinary leadership in ensuring accountability of government, as well as championing the interests of its members. Let me first attempt to address EA's concern on the Local Government Service Council. Yes. Monday, 4th of October, the Local Government Service Council will be inaugurated. Today, the fourth edition of the Netankwao Excellence Award Ceremony has brought all stakeholders under one umbrella as a way of recognizing the efforts of members who have shown diligence and professionalism in the performance of their duties, and especially exhibiting the essentialities of political neutrality. On the topic, we are privileged to have an astute professor of local governance delivering the public lecture on neutrality in local governance, non-partisan election of MMDCs. I've known Prof. Achuaye for long and is someone that most of us have cited in our works. He's such an expert in the subject that I believe we shall have a very exciting public lecture. I don't want to comment on the topic because I have my position. So I don't want to comment on that. Prof, it's a pillar. But if you ask me, I will say that election of MMDCs might be partisan. If you ask me, Prof, you know better. So you come and tell us whether it should be partisan or nonpartisan. As members of the civil and local government service, our contribution towards the port and socioeconomic development of Ghana is one that is highly remarkable. I'd like to take this opportunity to congratulate all members who will be recipients of the various categories of awards tomorrow and admonish them to continue in the same pace or even more, ensuring that Ghana becomes a model of an effective civil and local government system. For those from the local government service, they were carefully selected based on hard work, professionalism, and their contribution towards the political neutrality project. Before I take my seat, let me take this opportunity to commend the Executive Secretary and your team, CLOSAC, in leading the negotiation team for improved conditions of service for members of the service, civil and local government service staff. I doff my hat for you, yes, and your team. I trust and believe that at the end of the day, we shall triumph under the able leadership of the years. I'm aware that it is before the senior presidential advisor, Honorable Yao Osaf Mafo, and I'm very hopeful that very soon there'll be good news from government for the civil and local government service staff. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So the next statement coming from the Office of the Head of the Civil Service, and here representing Nana Jamna is his able chief director. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Brock.
Thank you very much. I was sitting down because I'm not doctor, but under the circumstances, thank you very much, El, for a few minutes, so I would enjoy that. The head of the local government service, colleague, chief directors, president of CLOSAC and the executive committee of CLOSAC, executive secretary, Professor Achuayi, staff of the civil and local government services, friends of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. On behalf of the head of the civil service and the entire civil service, I wish to congratulate CLOSAC on the occasion of the fourth year of this prestigious award ceremony, the Nathan Anankwao, and now it's the Annual Lectures and Excellence Awards. We commend CLOSAC for effectively discharging the objective of providing better representation for government workers and serving as a recognized channel of communication with government on matters affecting the services. And as the head of the local government service said, they're doing a very good job in leading the discussions for improved services for the staff. Indeed, the Office of the Head of Civil Service recognizes your immense role, not only in relation to the very strong representation and advocacy for the improvement in the conditions of service of your members, but also in championing the promotion of very strong value system in the civil and local government services. Today's event is a clear indication of your efforts at recognizing and promoting values such as leadership, integrity, professionalism, loyalty, selfishness, and political neutrality as essential values necessary for the performance of the civil service and the local government service staff. It is important to know that these were the values that distinguished Mr. Nathan Anankwal while serving successive governments spanning over 40 years. I believe, and he has just made mention of that, that the Excellence Awards were instituted not only to celebrate the distinguished civil servant, but also to emphasize the critical need for civil and local government service staff to uphold these values and to remain non-partisan in the performance of our duties and service to this nation. The Ghana Civil Service embraces these value systems as explicitly stated in our code of conduct. And as we seek to initiate and promote new reforms to improve the service, we must remember the key values and principles of the service that buttress our performance and service delivery to meet the aspirations of the good people of Ghana. We salute CLOSAC for the institution of the neutrality project and their continuous promotion of the culture of political neutrality in the services. We say Ayeko to your association. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, our gathering here today is to recognize and award distinguished CLOSAC members who have exhibited these key values and principles of political neutrality in the discharge of their duties. But it is also further to expand the discourse on improving the local governance system for the benefit of our country. The theme for this year's celebration, neutrality in local governance, non-partisan election of MNDCs, expands the frontier of the neutrality project and seeks to further explore areas of applicability to improve our governance system. I'm happy that the guest speaker, Professor Ayi, would help us interrogate this theme and give us the needed perspectives on the theme. However, let me briefly state that the mandate of the services will remain paramount as we continue as a nation to discuss the issue of election of MMDCs. Whichever way, MMDCs will require the effective performance of the civil and local government service to support them to deliver on their mandates of the assemblies. The interface between public and local governance for public services will continue to be the civil and local government service organizations. So as members of CLOSAC, we must therefore stand tall in upholding our principles of political neutrality by remaining focused, professional, and accountable in the delivery of our mandate without taking sides at any point in time. I want to seize the opportunity to congratulate all the award winners for their dedication and selflessness to the growth of our nation. A lot of you have made immense contribution to our services and to our nation, and the time to recognize you is now. It is my hope that this award scheme will engender more excellent service delivery by staff to the people of Ghana and make all members of CLOSAC work extra hard, bearing in mind the principles of our value system. I wish to thank the leadership of CLOSAC for the opportunity and also thank them once again for the immense support during our just ended Civil Service Week celebration and award ceremony. Let me end by charging all of us to remain active, professional, and non-partisan actors in our governance system, emulating the life and conduct of our very own Mr. Nathan Anankwao. Thank you very much.
Hey, government, don't take the bird. Take the civil servants and make them better. Remember to buy back civil servants. Then you can start to make Ghana better. Hey, government, don't be afraid. We are behind you in whatever you do. Remember to buy back civil servants. Then you begin to make Ghana better. Anytime you hear us cry, friends, refrain and listen to all that we are saying. Don't you know we need your help to hold our hands and carry us up upon your shoulders? Na 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 na. Hey, government, don't let us down. Now you've had us, go up and help us. Remember to buy back civil servants. Then you can start to make Ghana better, 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 better. Ah, da, da, na, 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 na. Hey, government. Ah, da, da, na, 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 na. Hey, government. Hey, government. Don't take it back. Take the civil servants and make them better. Remember to buy back civil servants. Then you begin to make Ghana better. Hey, government, don't be afraid. We are behind you in whatever you do. Remember to buy back civil servants. Then you can start to make Ghana better. Anytime you hear us cry, hey, government, refrain and listen to all that we are saying. Don't you know we need your help to hold our hands and carry us up upon your shoulders? Don't let us down. You have had us, now go and help us. And remember to buy back civil servants. Then you begin to make Ghana better, 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 better. Ah, da, 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 da.
Thank you very much. I thought the applause would be louder. Trust Clocks Act, they will take every opportunity to tell government their peace of mind. That song you just heard, I understand, is available on Clocks Act Media, so you can get in touch with them for a copy. In the meantime, let me inform all that this event is being streamed live on all Clocks Act platforms, Clocks Act Facebook, Clocks Act Twitter, and YouTube. It's also being streamed live on CTFM's platforms, their Facebook and YouTube platforms. Let's acknowledge the presence of an important personality here in our midst, representing the minority Speaker of Parliament, Honorable Haruna Idrisu, is another very important MP, the Member of Parliament for Ododo-Dodo. Ladies and gentlemen, please make feel welcome, Honorable Nilante Vanderpoy. I'm directed that you're supposed to be seated in this chair here. Kindly follow the usher. Thank you so much. Another round of applause. It means we'll have a good balance of politicians and civil servants in the House to get a very buoyant discussion. So let's get to it straight away. Why are we here this morning? A lecture and a discussion. And to do that for us, in fact, the theme is neutrality in local governance, nonpartisan election of MMDCEs. Do you agree with it or not? Whatever it is, let's listen to it from the professional, from the lecturer, and then after that, we'll come in with our opinions. Please welcome Professor Achiu Aye, the University of Ghana.
Head of the Local Government Service, Chief Director of the Office of the Head of the Civil Service, Chief Directors represented here, Executive Secretary of Clocks Act, staff of the Civil and Local Government Services, the media, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to be asked by Clocks Act to give the fourth Nathan Kwahu lecture. I must say that even though the years of Clocks Act have made the point that Mr. Nathan Kwahu attended Accra Academy, I would like to tell him that Mr. Nathan Kwahu was the foundation headmaster, you know, of Keta Secondary School, my alma mater. he did very wonderful, and one of the students' houses has been named after him. That's the first house, Kwahu House, is still there. So he meant a lot of things to me when he was alive. I interacted with him. Unfortunately, I couldn't get to him to look at his biography. I mean, that's because he had very useful insights about politics, about administration, about almost everything in Ghana. It's a pity that he passed on at the time he did. So it's a very important topic dear to my heart, dear to the heart of everybody, very topical issue, neutrality in local governance, non-partisan election of MMDCs. And it came just on the heel of the nomination of the president to the assemblies for the election of MMDCs. So what I intend to do in this paper is to look at a few things. First, I'll define the doctrine or the principle or the ethos of neutrality. If you look at this, if you look at neutrality, it has three different names. In political science, it's only a few of the concepts which will have this. It's a doctrine, it's a principle, it is an ethos. And that gives you the importance of neutrality. So I'll go into that, I'll define it briefly. I'll go to look at the historical reasons for the non-partisan election of MMDCs. First, I'd like to say that I don't like the word partisan, because if you look at partisan, the meaning is that it is a supporter of a political party with entrenched position, who does not want to compromise with political opponents. That's what partisan. So we have partisan politics, party politics. What we actually want is non-multi-party election of MMDCs. Non-multi-party election of MMDCs. Because partisan is pejorative, it is negative. But I try to use what I was given to me, and then our goal as we go along, we can make the necessary correction. So it should be the non-multi-party election of MMDCs. So I'll look at that. Then I'll go on to look at the argument. There are two arguments to this thing, to this debate. One says that Ghana is not ready. So we call it the Ghana is not ready argument. Why MMDCs should not be elected on partisan or multi-party basis. Why? That Ghana is not ready. We are not ready. We are not there yet. So why are we rushing? Then the counter argument is that the Ghana is ready argument. That why not? We are ready, and therefore MMDC should be elected on multi-party basis. Then, of course, I'll look at the other side. You see, some people are saying that yes, we can have elections, but not multi-party elections, but just election of MMDCs. They don't want the parties to come in because the parties are destructive. The parties are already polarized. So yes, let us have elections. And they go on to say that we can start with the election of MMDCs, not on party basis, but just elect them as we go on. I have some risks involved in that. Then, of course, I'll make some concluding remarks and the lessons that we can learn. So, what is neutrality? Neutrality could be traced to this dichotomy between politics and administration. And we can trace this from the writings of Max Weber, the German scholar who did a lot of work on bureaucracy. You can find that he has drawn a distinction between politics and administration. And then, of course, Woodrow Wilson, who used to be the professor of political science in Princeton University and became the 28th president of the U.S. He also made a clear distinction that political issues are not administrative issues, neither are administrative issues political issues. So that distinction, they've drawn that distinction, but I always say that the two have been misunderstood. What they were referring to is that bureaucrats should not be involved in partisan politics. That's all that they were trying to do. So that dichotomy is no longer there. There is a blurring of the lines between politics and administration. You cannot separate them. They're inseparable. They're like Siamese twins, politicians and administrators. They must work together to promote growth, the growth of a country. And therefore, that distinction or dichotomy is misplaced and misunderstood. So what is neutrality? Well, in neutrality, we want to say that the public servant, the civil servant, the local government servant must serve the chief executive of the day with total loyalty, with their ability, what have you, irrespective of their own political beliefs. So if you are talking about neutrality, people look at it from the political level that the bureaucrat or the administrator must serve the government of the day with total loyalty, irrespective of his political affiliations. He has to avoid conflict of interest, And if he's confronted with issues, he must actually try to be impartial. He must put his politics in his pocket, and then he can move on. So I'll deal with those issues later. But there are two forms of neutrality, which you must note. So when we are using neutrality, it's not only, so most of us refer to it at the political level. But neutrality has two forms. The first form is what we call administrative or bureaucratic neutrality, which means that the civil servant, the local government, you know, servant is actually involved in making sure that the rules, the processes, the regulations are followed and the public interest is promoted. So he does not actually bring his own interests here. So when he is serving the public, even though he has his own biases, his own ethnic background, his own family biases, whatever biases that he has, he has to follow the rules and regulations in serving the public. He cannot say that because you are an Akan, you are Fanti, you are an Ebe, you are a Gan, I must serve you based on your ethnic, religious affiliation. That's what we call administrative neutrality. Then we go on to look at political neutrality, which means that, look, you are in a political environment serving political masters. Irrespective of the government of the day, you must work within. You must not serve, you must serve the government of the day, right? You must serve the government of the day. But I want to tell you that this whole issue of political neutrality is a myth. It's a myth because we all know that civil servants, local government, you know, servants work within a highly intense political environment. Even in taking their own decisions, the priorities, what have you, once you have selected one priority over the other, you are in the realm of politics. So civil servants, local government, you know, servants themselves, because they are designing policies, they are implementing policies, these policies work within highly political environment. And therefore, if you look at the literature around, the argument is that neutrality is a myth. It no longer exists because of the proliferation of government activities and the various stakeholders that are involved. So let's look at the two pieces of legislation. So if you are looking at neutrality in Ghana, two pieces of legislation and the judgment of the Supreme Court have all reinforced the neutrality argument. Now, so the first legislation is, well, the 1992 Constitution, Article 94.3b. A person shall not be eligible to be a member of parliament if he is a member of these services, right? They've listed them. But conspicuously absent are some of the other services, including the Ghana Health Service and the Ghana Education Service. So why is that so? Others will say that, well, once the judgment of the Supreme Court has said these, the civil and local government services are included, excluded, it will also apply to the other services. It's a very contentious issue. I'll return to that later. Then, of course, we have the Civil Service Code of Conduct, 1999, Section 12.1, B and all that, which says that, well, the 1992 Constitution has given rise to all of us to join political parties and all that, but civil servants are debarred from open partisanship. right? Which means that you are not supposed to do all these things, right? So that's the other piece of legislation. So the code itself is prohibitive of the open partisanship. You see, and the argument is that how can you tell open partisanship? It went on to list this, that you must not be associated with a political party in accepting any office paid or unpaid. You cannot be a permanent or temporary staff of a political party. And the argument is that the civil service is serving the government of the day, and therefore you must be loyal. That will bring trust and confidence. And I must stress this here, that trust and confidence in the civil and local government services are very important. Once the trust and confidence are eroded, you are more or less dealing with a very dangerous precedent. The dangerous precedent is that the civil and local government services are there irrespective of the government in power. And that is why when there is even a transition in government, the civil and local government services are there. So we need the civil and local government services throughout. That is why this issue of neutrality has been stressed. Okay, the final one, which is not a legislation, is the June 2017 Supreme Court ruling. The 9-member panel at the time unanimously ruled, and they made a very important point, and I want to quote there. At this stage of our socio-political development, when political discourse is all pervasive and rivalry can easily trigger a whole range of reactions, including even violence, it will be most unhealthy to countenance civil and local government servants who publicly proclaim their political leanings in the public space. So that is the decision. That is it. That judgment. But then at the same time, if you read on, the Supreme Court made a very important point that, yes, you can, as a civil and local government service staff, because the assemblies are apolitical, you can be part of it. But the same decision made a very important point about conflict of interest, that if you are local government or civil servant and you have been sworn in as a member of the assembly, if you are the one who is going to collect tax, and if you belong to the same body who passed the legislation, the bylaw for the tax, then you are in a conflict of interest position. And therefore, you must do what? You should resign. Very difficult. And that is why I actually applaud the point the years of Klosak made, that yes, some people are being appointed. But you see, the argument is that it's a gray area judgment. Maybe we may have to go back to the Supreme Court. Because if you are saying that, well, yes, you can be, because the assembly is apolitical. But once you are sworn in and you become a member, then, of course, a conflict of interest will have arisen. So what do you do? It's a very controversial issue. But this is what we have now. So two pieces of legislation and the judgment of the Supreme Court. Right, so what are the reasons for the non-partisan election of MMDC? So, okay, so it has been summarized. If you look at all the reports, the report of the National Commission for Democracy, if you look at the report of the CRC, the Constitutional Review Commission, some reasons have been given. The first one is that it says that in the past, central governments in Ghana have exerted undue influence on local government bodies to win political advantage. In the past, they are referring to the CPP days. And I will tell you that we had multi-party elections to local governments, 1957 to 1959. That's it, 2 years. So I do not understand why people, or why the same report is saying that, oh, if you go back to the CPP days, people were elected, and then they, there was the the government of the day exerted undue influence. That is not the case. The case is that real multi-party election of local government councillors actually was between 1957 and 1959, right? So that's one. The second argument is that, look, at the local level, all that we need is local developments. So what's the point? So you need to have consensus. These are very important. You need to mobilize people. So if you bring party politics in, it will divide. So party politics is divisive. I'll come to that. The third argument is that the political parties themselves do not have the ability to mobilize resources to organize district-level elections. This was made by the then chairman of the Electoral Commission, Dr. Farijan. He made that point. And then the other argument is that, well, the Electoral Commission itself lacks the capacity to organize such an election based on multi-party. So it cannot do that. Then, of course, the other argument which has been made is that, well, at the local level, you need teamwork, you need a common understanding of issues, you need communication. If you bring the parties in, they'll create problems. So we don't need them. And then, of course, you see, the other one which I want to stress here is that if you look at the non-party local government system was under the Provisional National Defense Council Rule, 1982 to 1992. So it is understandable that when a military government has excluded multi-party based elections in local governance, it's clear because political parties were not there, were not in existence between 1982 and 1992. So it is understandable we have that. So yes, it was incorporated because it was incorporated in the 1992 constitution because one, the government did not have the hindsight of looking at political parties. The second issue is that if you read Dr. Obed Asamoah's book, if you read P.V. Obin's memoirs, they made the point that the inclusion of the multi-party election in the district assemblies is to satisfy the revolutionaries. It's clear in their books, in the memoirs of Mr. P.V. Obin and in the book of Dr. Obed Asamoah. So the argument is that, yes, the non-partisan or the exclusion of political parties in local governance election was based on the fact that the political parties were not there, and it was meant to satisfy the revolutionaries. But are these conditions still in existence? I'll say no. So let's go now. What are the reasons against the partisan election of MMDCs? Why are people saying that we don't need the political parties in? And as I said, Ghana is not ready argument. The first one, to me, is the fear factor. People are afraid that when the parties come in, they will polarize the assemblies, it will lead to violence, it will lead to division. And I always ask this basic question, that where in the world you have party politics at the national level and at the local level, you have non-parties? There are few countries we have. Even I'll tell you that Denmark in 1953 barred political parties in the local governance system. But in 1990s, they reversed that decision. Now you have political parties being part of the system. But the point I want to stress here is that multi-party democracy is the game in town. You can have only few countries which do not practice multi-party democracies. You can talk of the Gulf states, Saudi Arabia, Oman, you know, Qatar, what have you, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, if you come to Africa, Eswatini, Swaziland, they don't have multi-party democracy. But the majority, it's only few countries which do not practice multi-party democracy. So the only game in town now is multi-party democracy. So why have we embraced multi-party at the national level and we are afraid to bring it to the local level? It is a serious contradiction. It is more or less, and we know that the political parties are there. I will tell you that the current system where the president nominates, assembly elects, and the president appoints is the partisan one. Because there is only one party there. It is only one party, the president, the government in power. That is all that. That is more partisan. And so if we are telling ourselves, and then of course, whether in the election of MNDCs, whether in the election of the 70%, what have you, the parties are there. So I've heard of some assemblies which have rejected the president's appointee. So you cannot ignore party politics at the local level. So when people say that, oh, we don't want the parties to come there, meanwhile, we know that they're there. It's an act of self-deception. We must move away from that. That's the issue of the... Then others also say that, look, when we bring in the parties, local development will suffer. They will bring their divisions, their factionalism and all that. And then, of course, the security, it will also compromise security. And us, these are not... do not have any basis for empirical discussion. Then, of course, the other argument is that if you bring the parties in, it will also sabotage the MMDC will sabotage the president. People who do not come from his party. So what is the big deal about it? So we all have that. Then, of course, people talk about, well, if you are not careful, if you bring in the parties, then, of course, monetization. We already have monetization of politics at the national level. So if you bring in the parties, there will be more monetization, there will be corruption. Then it will also undermine the neutrality of the local bureaucracy. We all have the decentralized departments at that level, 16, 13, 11 for metropolitan, municipal, and district, respectively. So if you are going to bring the political parties, you are going to create a problem. Then others have also made the point that, well, it will also make, if you bring in the party, it will also make the president not being able to dismiss non-performing MMDCs, right? And then the other argument, people say there is no single international best practice. There is no uniformity. So there are rather best practices. In some countries, they elect. In other countries, they do not elect. So what is the big deal? We must look at the Ghanaian context and see what is right for the Ghanaian context. So let us go on with the current system. And then, of course, the argument others have made is that if you bring the parties in, it will also debar civil and local government servants from the work of the assemblies. So what are the reasons for bringing in the parties? So now people are saying that, yes, Ghana is ready. We are ready to elect MMDCs on multi-party basis, right? And the argument is that we have been talking about the winner takes all. So if we need to reduce the winner takes all, we can elect MMDCs on multi-party basis. So you bring in all the parties and they come and then they can. In some areas, actually, the minority parties we have been talking about, the minority parties are usually not functional after elections. So the PNC, the CPP and the others may win some districts. So it will also reduce the winner takes all and will deepen the country's democracy. Now, if you look at the current system, it is exclusionary. It excludes all the other political parties. The appointment of the MMDCs, if you look at the 70% who will stand for election, they stand there because the parties have sponsored them. And the government of the day appoints 30%. So whether we like it or not, the current system is polarized politically already. So what is the big deal about, oh, we want non-partisanship? It must continue. The structure itself is polarized politically already. So we should not be more or less deceiving ourselves that neutrality is fine. Yes, neutrality is fine, but what is the level of neutrality? I think that's what we should talk about. The degree of neutrality, and that's where the problem is. You can't have total neutrality. You can have a modicum or a degree of neutrality. Given the fact that the operations of government, the operations have become highly politicized, especially when the administrator himself will have to take political decisions. Then others will say, then the other argument is that, well, why not? If you look at the current system, the MMDC is more or less not accountable to the people. It's accountable to the president. It's accountable to the assembly. So, well, that is that. So, but if you bring in the parties, if the parties are there, then they can promote more accountability. It will also improve the quality of MMDCs and assembly members. Right now, people are saying that even if you look at the quality of MMDCs, it's not as good as we have. If you look at the quality of those who stand for elections, and of course those who are those who are appointed by the president, the quality is not as good. But when you bring in the parties, because they are competing, competition is very important in politics. If there is no competition, quality will begin. I've raised this argument and said that who tells you that, oh, party politics brings quality? The parties will act as a sieve. You know what a sieve is? There are a lot of people, so they'll sieve the good ones, right? That's what party, because of the competition, right? Actually, whether we like it or not, in reality, the two major parties are deeply involved at the local level. We cannot deny that. We know it. And then surveys have shown all over the years that MMDC should be elected. Some say elect on party. Others say don't elect on party. It's a big issue. Then, of course, I always say that there's a contradiction between Articles 35.6d and Articles 55.3. You see, Article 35.6d says that the state must take measures to decentralize to the regions, bring resources, etc., etc. Whilst Article 55 says that, well, political parties can perform all functions except they cannot elect people to local government or other lower local government units. That's a contradiction. On one hand, make democracy a reality through decentralization. On the other hand, we are saying that, oh, we don't want political parties can do whatever they want, but we don't like them to be part of local government. It's a contradiction. Actually, if you look at the countries which have developed, the UK, the US, other countries, they have a strong local governance system, and most of their leaders are trained. The local government system becomes a training ground for future national leaders. And therefore, we want our politicians to learn what is politics. Politics is a profession. So all of a sudden, we have people who have not served at the local level. And I will tell you that if you look at the 1993 batch of MPs, a few of the MPs serve as members of the district assemblies. And so they learn even the debating aspect of it. Now, all of a sudden, we have at the national level, I want to become an MP. And so the rudiments of debate, the rudiments of give and take are not learned. There must be a conscious internalization of the values of democracy. And this can only take place from the local level. Then, of course, if you look at district level elections, they have not been attended. The turnout has been very low. And one of the reasons, I have done some study, and the key reason is that, look, people are not galvanized enough. It's only the political parties which can mobilize. So the mobilization spirit has not been there, so people are not eager. The other thing is that people do not see the relevance of the assembly because the assemblies are performing poorly. So, but the argument is that if the parties are in, they have the capacity to mobilize people. And of course, the other arguments about it is difficult to achieve neutrality and all that, I have said that already. But the one I want to leave with you is that, you see, we have practiced this system since 1988. Of course, we practiced it since 1993. Democratic, almost getting to 30 years. And yet still, there are problems. So if there are problems, we need to look back, take stock, and see how best we can fine-tune. Socrates made a very important point that an unexamined life is not worth living. So I think we need to take stock and look at what we did. So because the system had been practiced for almost about 30 years, and we still have recurring problems, issues, etc. I don't want to go into this about monetization and what have you. Okay, so now let me come to this whole issue of the other argument which is being made is that, yes, we can elect, but we don't want the parties in because the parties are divisive, they have polarized already. So let us elect on no party basis. And that's the argument. So I think that this argument has some potential risks. The first risk is that, look, it will create more monetization because now you have financiers who will be financing people who are not aligned to any of the political parties, or they may be aligned, but we are going to have faceless financiers who are financing people who do not have any political agenda, right? So that's a very potential risk that we need to look at. Then, of course, it will perpetuate the winner takes all. The minority parties will still be excluded or marginalized. And if you don't take it, because you see, if you have lost national elections, how do you make sure that the minority parties also participate in local elections? If you make it non-party, it becomes a free-for-all fight. And that is why, you see, because when the parties are in, you are going to regulate these individuals. But if the parties are not there, it's going to be a free-for-all fight. It will not eliminate the current unconstitutional and secret sponsorship of political parties who will be contesting district-level elections. And then, of course, it will not also improve the quality of local leadership because the parties are not there to act as sieves and all that. Then, of course, it will not resolve the whole issue of the conflict between MPs and MMDCs. If you don't bring the parties in, it will not. Because now you are going to elect without the parties. So the conflict between MMDCs and then DCs, part of it revolves not only on the common fund, but on the tenure of office. The MDC serves two terms. That's it. The member of parliament serves, unless you are no longer elected, so you can serve even how many terms? 5, 6, 7 terms. The MMDC serves two terms. Now this, if you bring in the parties, the likelihood that we are not going to have the, it will still exacerbate, the conflict. And then, of course, we talk about the voter turnout will also not improve because now the parties are still out of it. Then, of course, I also talk about, the contradictions and the controversies and then the conflict over the past 30 years about this system. 30 years, this system has been tried and tested, and we have not been able to achieve much what is, expected. So my conclusion, I think that neutrality can best be described, but not practiced. We can only describe it, but we cannot practice, given the fact that the politician, the bureaucrat, they all work in highly polarized environments, political environment, right? The bureaucrat is also taking decisions which have political implications, right? So what do you bring? So neutrality will be a question of degree. We cannot achieve total neutrality, but a degree of neutrality. We should also deal with this fear factor that political parties are not good. If they are not good, we should regulate them. I think that the Electoral Commission has not been able to regulate political parties, and that's why I have called for the setting up of a separate regulatory commission which should actually regulate political parties. They are supposed to do a lot of things, but nobody is regulating the political parties. They are doing their own things. We cannot look at the failure of the system and said multi-party democracy is bad. So we must deal with the failures of the system. So that fear factor must be exercised. The fear of political parties must be exercised. And if it has to be exercised, then what can we do? Then we need to look at them. And I have also proposed some recommendations. For instance, in terms of the sensitization, in terms of the structure, in terms of schooling political parties, et cetera, et cetera. Then, of course, this one, the second bullet, I've already mentioned that the administrative state is already politically contestable. So you cannot say that you have a neutral administrative state. The neutral administrative state is no longer in existence because of the highly political environment within which all of us work. So non-partisan election, we practiced it for over 30 years with problems. The time has come for us to change, and we should not be deceiving ourselves. It is difficult to eliminate partisanship from the operations of the MMDAs. It's difficult. We cannot eliminate all these things. And then, of course, there is also this mentality that local development and party politics are not, cannot be practiced together. I think that this non-partisan election versus local development is a mirage. We still have the assemblies. Yes, we have some development, but there is more. 30 years. If you have practiced a system for 30 years and it has not worked, then you need to reform. You need to reform. It is only it is only an unexamined life, which is not worth living. So why cannot? Reform is the order of the day. So we need to look at reform. And then, of course, I've already mentioned the point that if you look at the local bureaucracy, the decentralized department, some of them are not fully integrated because of bureaucratic politics. Well, it was health, it was education. Now they are saying they want to bring them in. I don't know whether they are able to bring them in. So it's still problematic. And so we need to look. So there is, you cannot say that even the bureaucrats are not politicians. They also engage in some politics. That should tell you the pervasiveness of politics. And my last point is that electing MMDCs without parties may be more dangerous than electing them with parties under which they can be controlled. All protocols observed, I rest my case. Thanks a lot. I'm sure you know we should do a better applause for him. Very interesting, the way he stuck to just a couple of slides and he spoke to the issues. Now he has spoken. Now we're going to take remarks, observations, contributions from strategically placed personalities. I'm going to take one from a pure politician. I'm going to take one from a pure public servant. I'm going to take one from someone who finds himself wedged in between the politician and the public and civil servant. And then I'm going to take one from Klocksak. I don't know where to position that one. Okay, so Honorable Nilante Van der Poy, definitely I'm sure you were itching in your seat with remarks and observations. If you could kindly join us, a big round of applause for him.
First, let me take the opportunity to say a big thank you to Klocksak for inviting the minority to come and join you in this very important lecture. And also, sir, thank you very much.
You may come to the podium.
Really?
Yeah, please. So that, yes. So that the networks will be able to capture you. Yeah.
When my lecturer has stood here, it's very difficult for me to want to.
Thank you.
In all the protocols that have been mentioned already, especially my very good brother and friend, Nana Tuatha, I'm particularly interested in this particular topic of the fact that I'm the ranking member for Local Government Committee in Parliament, and I've also served as an Assembly member and now as an MP. I've been a Deputy Minister for Local Government, and I call myself a local government practitioner. So it's very important to me. And thank you very much. I will ask first that you give us the transcript of your presentation. It will help our debate in Parliament. First, I would say my thoughts about neutrality in the civil and local government service is very important to me. Let me give you a very short experience. When I was made Minister for Local Government, the secretary in my office is a sister of a member of parliament from the opposition. Blood sister. And he brought her to that office when he was a deputy minister. So the contention was that change her, because your loyalty cannot be assured. But I came in with one principle, that which Ghanaian is not political? And if you have to look at people's noses and ears, their foreheads, in order to work with them, then you may not be able to achieve your result. I'm a sportsman and a footballer. Not all of us in a particular team are friends. We come from various backgrounds, but the objective is to work together to achieve results. It was the same when I went to the Ministry of Youth and Sports as a substantive minister. You know all the issues about the ministry before I went there, the mafias and all those things. and people said, those people, they are dangerous. What it means is that if you don't take good care of them, they will finish you. I think it's by God's desire, plan, to have you work in the civil service and not by the hand of any politician. So what I expect a civil servant, a local government staff to do, to know that I am only privileged to be occupying this office. Because you may not be the most handsome, the most beautiful, the most intelligent Ghanaian, but you are working. Somebody may be more qualified than you is sitting at home without a job. So you must first count on the privilege that has been presented to you to serve. And once you have that at the back of your mind, it doesn't matter who is sitting in front of you as your boss. You work diligently first in reverence to your God that has given you the opportunity to have that position and for the building of the nation. That's my priority. And that's the way I see everybody. I see you as somebody first, having been given the opportunity just like me to be in that position. And then two, with the desire to serve this country before I look at other considerations. And I think if all of us will have that mentality and that psyche, it doesn't really matter who you work under. It doesn't really matter who you're working with. It doesn't really matter who you work for. We all achieve the desired results. That's my view about the neutrality. Yes, it will be difficult for anyone to say I'm politically neutral. You work with people and you develop a relationship with a person. One of the most fantastic people I've seen in the civil service, my time, moving from the public service GBC into the civil service as a minister, are the secretaries in our various offices. Fantastic ladies. The matured ones, they serve you with care, with love. And I want to see who amongst them will say, I'm not going to serve my boss because I am MPP, I am NDC. And he is this, he is that. Because you don't see it in their work. You don't see it in their delivery. And you don't see it in how they smile towards you. It depends on your personal relationship with them that could make them want to do better to serve you. And I appreciate that. My next point, Prof, I think we'll have time to sit down and argue about this very well. This time, this particular forum is not there. We've had a series of arguments on this election of MMDCs. I'm all for it. I've read the chapter from the report of the Constitutional Review Commission. I've listened to you before. I've listened to Dr. Sain. I've listened to a lot of the local government experts. The truth of the matter is that we, the politicians, will not allow it to work. That's a fact. We, the politicians, will not allow. Nana Atuata at all means will not allow. So you see, even here. Is it the winner takes all concept is real. And there's so much mistrust between us that no matter how dedicated and committed that person who has been elected on another political party of a ticket to occupy an MMDA position, for me to trust him. I've always asked, today, when we go on rounds as local government committee, the disposition of the MMDCs towards members of the committee that come from the majority is different from their disposition towards us. It's real. They feel more comfortable with their party people than us. except when it's obvious the person has a relationship with you or has that respect for you for who you are. So, I think that, yes, we must elect MMDCs, but I am always of the view that, look, if we go strictly partisan the way we have gone, there are certain places that there is no way standing here. I'm so disposed towards working for the district, I will get elected because I belong to another political party. And our political party nominations have not been on the issue of competence and capability, patronage. So somebody in the district, the same political party, may be more qualified, but because he is not the lover boy of that political bigwig, the kingmaker in that district, will never get elected as the nominee to contest on the ticket of the party for MMDC. Today, at the parliamentary level, there are certain constituencies the chairman will tell you, I'm getting you to become MP. And when you go, your first car is for me. Nana is aware, some constituencies, I don't want to mention name. And if you don't do it, you'll be one term. That chairman will bring somebody to contest you the next primaries, and you are off. Because they control the delegates. Do we want to see the same thing replicated at the assembly level? The reason why I am passionate, because I love local governance. And when I see that danger, that python, getting down to a local level, I'm sure by the time we reorganize, we'll be sitting here in the next 15, 20 years to make the same argument, let's reform. So the reality of the dangers we face is that, yes, certain places being practiced well because they are not overtly political in nature. But we Ghanaians, we copy and overcopy. We take things and we become extremists of those attitudes. That is the danger I foresee. But I'm all for election of MMDCs. It will stop all these corruption, all these routes and violence and that characterize the appointment of MMDCs. But the truth of the matter is that political patronage, political coercion, could possibly overtake the principle of competence and of apoliticization of the concept. This is my few comments I want to make on this issue. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So please, we'll be, if you could resume your seat, we'll be coming to you with, I have a lot of questions stringing to my mind. Nana Tuata, please join us over here. And give us your remarks. We have observed you reacting and interjecting. What's your position on this?
Thank you very much, Prof. That's a wonderful presentation. Your last slide, electing MMDCs without parties may be more dangerous than electing them with parties. I totally agree with you. Prof, you said that neutrality is best described but cannot be practiced. I think that can be practiced, but with a degree. It can be practiced with a degree. Because of the topic that you were giving, Prof, you were on the MMDCs, but what about the assembly members? As I sat here, today, at Abra Sebu Kwamankese, a DC is to be confirmed. The assembly that we say is nonpartisan. The NDC is saying that give us the presiding member position. If we give it to us, we'll help you confirm your DC. So assemblies are partisan. 20 years ago, when I was appointed to become DC in KEA, that is where you see the number of NDC people in Elmina, the number of PPP. That there was no CPP. PPP, it was CPP. The assemblies are already partisan. We are just playing ostriches. Prof, my question is this. The Ghana is not ready argument. There's a time factor. So when will Ghana be ready? If you say Ghana is not ready, when will Ghana be ready? 30 years, as per PNDC Law 207. Since 1988, 32 years plus, we are still where we are. And we are saying Ghana is not yet ready. So when will Ghana ever be ready? If the researchers will be able to tell us, then we know that, oh, there's a timeline. Let's work with it the next 10 years. Then I will understand it. But I think that Ghana is ready. I think that Ghana is ready. So what are we waiting for? I will agree with Honorable, my good friend, Honorable Nilamte, when he talked about I wouldn't allow, I think he will allow the process to continue. Because today, wherever you go, election of assembly members, MPP is organizing primaries, NDC is organizing primaries, something that we say is nonpartisan. Why are they secretly organizing these primaries? And they're illegal, as far as our constitution is concerned. But it's being practiced. Why is it so? Prof, you made mention of low-level elections at the lower level. Between, you're right, between 35 and 40, maximum 42% in 2004. Meanwhile, when you talk about the national level elections, it's between 75 and 80%. Because at the lower level, the political parties are not openly involved, whereby they'll be able to mobilize their people to go and then vote. So if you talk about 35-60, where the Constitution says that we should, as much as possible, at the lower level, there must be participatory democracy. How are we allowing our people to participate if at the lower level elections, places 22% of our people participate and elect somebody to represent you at that electoral area? 22%. So how are they participating at the lower level elections? So for me, my position is simple. Having gone through DCE days, Deputy Regional Minister, MP, and today as the head of local governments, service, I'm of the view that the time has come today that we revisit the referendum that was aborted. We need to revisit it. If you look at today, the appointment and the hullabaloo around it, if we were to elect MMDCs, by this time we'd have done the election long ago. And I agree with you. The winner takes all. Reduced, assuming today we are having MMDC's elections. You go to some parts of Volta Uti, you could get some on the ticket of NDC. And MMDCs are part of the executive, isn't it? So now, this system of MPP comes to power 7 January, 8 January, Nilante and their team are campaigning. If NDC is in power, 8 January, MPP is campaigning. How does the party even get stabilized to even appoint their ministers for them to start work? If we get some of the MMDCs from other political parties, I believe that it will help us to build nation inclusively. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, Prof, there was... So please assume this. Hello. Yeah, let me say quickly that we'll be taking some questions from our viewers off Facebook. So please keep the questions coming. I've seen a couple of comments. You're talking about a beautiful program and all that. No, we want hardcore questions. So Prof will respond to the comments that came so far. And then I'll go to Mr. Michael Usu Unimaku and then Dr. Theophilus Adumaku for their comments from the public sector. Yeah, yes. Please.
No, I agree with Honorable Neil Antivandapo about the fact that when you bring in the parties, the fear is that political patronage will overtake competence and expertise. Yes, it may be true, but how about the current system? The current system is more or less the same. Are we bringing in competent people even at the national level, you know? But the argument you made is very, you made about, oh, in certain areas, if you bring in the parties, there is no way an MMDC may come from that area. So the president, in order to balance ethnic differences, he can appoint people from other areas. It's a legitimate argument, but does that solve the problem? I don't think that has solved the problem. We have practiced it for 30 years. We have all these problems. People are still saying that the president is not appointing their people, their ethnic people, as MMDC. It's still the same thing. And even in the appointment of the 30%, people are still complaining about the president, you know, sidelining their ethnic group for other groups. So we'll still have such problem. I think that if something is new, we can fine-tune it. This system has been there for 30 years. We should fine-tune it. The only way we can fine-tune it is to reform it. I think that's what we want to do. The other issue which engineer Dr. Arthur raised is very important, that I've talked about MMDCs. How about the assembly itself? You see, you cannot have a multi-party elected MMDCs working with the current structure of the assembly. 70% elected on no party, 30% appointed by the president. I think we should go the full hall of electing everybody. That's the way. You see, democracy is not about contradictions. When you bring in contradictions, it will not work. Democracy is about putting in place workable, functional structures. And I think so, when I'm asking for the election of MMDCs, I'm also asking for the election of assembly members and all that. So we must go a full hall into the structure. But the only problem which people have raised is, do we have the EC, the Electoral Commission, has it got the capacity to organize elections? That's the other problem. So, yes, it's a very difficult issue, particularly when people have actually raised issues about the current system. We have problems. The presidents have actually complained that they have spent sleepless nights appointing MMDCs. Sleepless nights. So why should we overburden our presidents who should be having a good rest after working well throughout the day? So I think that, yes, we have problems. Let us fix the problems.
Thank you. Okay, so I said we're going to have some comments from public servants. Mr. Michael Ousunimaku is a former secretary to the Public Services Commission. Please welcome him. Facebook, please keep your questions coming so we can pick them for Prof.
Yeah, is it afternoon? Yeah, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, I would first like to thank CLOSAG for this invitation. That's something I was not expecting. So Isaac and your team, I'm so grateful. Yeah. And Prof, you took us back to the classroom once again. Yes. And we thank you for that. Yes. I don't know where to start. After the two politicians have they've turned our heads around. Yes. But I'm coming from the point of a pure public servant. You know, these rules and laws that we have on this subject, we just implement, okay? Even where you have your own let's say, questions or challenges with the law, all that you can do is to implement. And I would like to first refer to the provision in the Constitution about some public services that are not supposed to be part, to take part in active participation in politics. The question that I used to ask when I was secretary to PSC is that, what was the basis for this selection? What was the basis for this selection? Because all of us are public servants. What makes some of us endangered species that cannot be part of something and others can? Okay, so that's a question that I've been asking myself. And Prof mentioned something. If you look at the list of the public services in Article 190, 1A, starting from the civil service all the way down to, I think, the legal service also, it doesn't mean that these are the only public services, but just that list. GES, Ghana Education Service, were taken out of that list, and I think Ghana Health Service, and the rest were put in the Constitution. So that also increases the questions that some of us had in our head, that why is it that some services cannot, so that's an issue for the framers of the Constitution, or those who review the Constitution in future, to look at it and give us more clarification. And the other point is this, and I come back to Honorable Nilante and my friend, Dr. Atta. You see, today you have somebody as, let's say, a deputy minister, okay, or a minister. Then tomorrow he's a chief executive of a public service organization, okay? Just related to what I just said, that assuming that this public service organization is an organization that's listed in the Constitution as an organization whose staff cannot engage in party politics, then here we are, somebody who has identified himself as a politician, let's say as a minister, as an MP, then becomes the head of this organization. So where are we? See, so that's something that I'm leaving there to ponder about. But Prof, with your lecture, some of the takeaways are multi-party democracy is the game in town, okay? And also, what we are doing is an act of self-deception. It's self-deception, they're saying that, look, I think both me and Dr. Atta talked about that when you see the campaign posters of your assemblymen, just looking at the posters, you know where they are coming from. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. If you have been observing, if it's an MPP person, you see blue, white, and red somewhere. And if it's an NDC person, you see some green, black, and so on. I've been watching that all over. Yes. So it's an act of self-deception. My contribution or my suggestion is that let's hold the bull by the horn and then go full partisan or election of DCEs all the way down there, as Prof alluded to Doc's point, you see. But the issue is that please let's sit down and put rules and some modalities in place so that they will guide us. That's all that I can say. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Secretary. Mr. Theophilos Adumaku is Dr. Theophilos Adumaku is a director for consultancy at the MDPI. Please welcome him. Yeah, he deals a lot with productivity. MDPI is a government institution that trains management personnel. So Management Development and Productivity Institute, he's there. Please, your comments. Sir.
Thank you, Mr. MC, all protocol reserved, and also we appreciate our professor who has taken part of his important time to come and lecture us on this important topic. And I think he has done justice to the topic. For that matter, all the issues and the gaps that affected us either accepting or rejecting the election of these important personalities in our governance did not actually go that well. But today, he has put us in another frame of thinking that if we are to be us in this room or we had the opportunity to vote, I think most of us will go along with him and say we should elect our MMDCs into office because of the additional information that he has given to us. So he has done well. But what I will also add is his lecture is limited to us in this room and those of us who have the chance to visit the social media. So respectfully, I will urge CLOSAC to extend the public discourse to the other regional capitals so that they will also be well informed as we have been informed. And if there's the need for us to revisit that important event, then all of us will be on the same wavelength, then we can participate fully and fully. Because from evidence and what we have all been told, it appears that globally, most countries that are into democracy are going by what Prof has suggested. However, lack of knowledge and understanding about the topic is creating confusion in our minds and also allowing our personal judgments and intuition to influence our actions and undermining the democracy that we have all chosen to practice. And I don't think that we will go back to any form of governance apart from the democracy that we've all accepted. So I would strongly urge that this courtesy is extended beyond Accra so that others can also participate and join us. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you, Ms. Dr. Adumakunwe. Yeah, he says that let the process be participatory countrywide. Okay, so we'll be opening the floor pretty soon. But then now I said we're going to talk to someone who found himself wedged between the politician and the civil servant. Nana Rex Owusu-Ansa is a former clerk to parliament. Can we welcome him upstage to... Yeah, maybe we give him the start. Okay, let's resume seat. Okay, so Nana wants to listen further before he contributes. So so we're going to open the floor for questions and contributions, but I have a question for both politicians and possibly Prof. Is it really, really, because we're assuming that once the election takes place at the MMDC's level, it will be nonpartisan somewhat, or it will be neutral in a way. Is that possible? Because even with elections on campuses, students' elections, we know that there is political infiltration. Let me go to the back and then to you. Honorable Neil Antivan, but is it possible? Or are we just trying to be hypocritical on this?
I have said already that I don't think anyone in this country will say I'm not political. So I agree, but I am saying that the dangers inherent in this must seriously be looked at. One of the issues I forgot to mention is we have certain districts that are formed by multiple tribal groupings. And so, in electing parliamentary candidates, it becomes obvious. If we go that way, possibly what is going to happen is that you may end up having the parliamentary candidate, the MMDC, all coming from one particular tribal line. It makes the other tribal grouping always agitative. So normally what this system has been used to do is to cure that. If the MP, for example, let me take for example this for example, Boko. So that if the MP is a Kusasi, then you manage the sentiments of the Mampurusi people with the position of the MMDC. But if you go straight election, since the Kusasis are more than the Mampurusis in Boko, they will pick the MPship and pick the MMDC position. Then the other group will always fail. It happened in the Bumpurugu Yogo. It happens in a lot of the districts in the northern, upper west regions where we have multiple tribal groupings within the same district. It's not like my place, AMA, where it's cosmopolitan, anybody at all could be there. Or in Ada, where obviously, or in KEA. But even in KEA, they will tell you, Commander Fo Ezidodo, and well, then Yenso, Elmina Fo Su Yezibi. Meboa, Nana, Oyampa. So these are the obvious problems that we as a country need to look at before we venture and say, all through political, let's go. Thank you.
Thank you. Normally, after the comment, there's supposed to be a little. So Klocksack's comment will come in. Let's round up on this one. So is it really purely possible? Or is this just, we're just tickling ourselves that it's likely, it's possible to make it nonpartisan, if that were the case?
I think you know my position. It's not possible. I've said it. It's not possible. That's why I said that. Even at the lower level that we say is supposed to be nonpartisan, MPP is in the room organizing primaries. NDC is in the room organizing primaries. They will tell you, if you don't do like that, 3 MPP people are there. There's only one NDC. NDC will be 4, so let us do primaries. So if you are going to go, we should go all out. My point is, if we say at lower level, it would be divisive. It will bring violence, chaos. Then why don't you scrap the one at the national level, the MP's one? Then why don't you scrap it? The lower level will bring violence if it becomes partisan. So the national level, it won't bring violence. So why are we entertaining that one, but we cannot entertain that one at the local level?
Thank you. So it is clear. Yeah, the Executive you. Secretary of Klocksack
will also give
position.
Our opinion. Well, as we all are aware, Klocksack, we have the neutrality project. So, of course, yes, as Prof made one of his statements in the decision that we'll be more happy if it is non-partisan because we can contest the district level elections. But the issue is this. We need to be very careful in giving decisions a political color at the local level. Just quite recently, the issue on Galamsey was given a political color and some people lost the contest just because of Stop Galamsey. So neutrality in local governance is what will develop our locals. Now, we've had so much intellectual discussion on this issue, it must end somewhere. We are aware that in the issue of electing MMDCEs, we have to be by referendum. Am I right, Prof? So why don't we also ask this question in the referendum and let the people decide? Because I can bet you this argument will go on and go on, won't end. Let the people decide by a referendum. So, Prof, if it's possible, maybe you can add your comments to it. If it's possible, let the people decide by a referendum. As we are going to take a referendum, to even decide whether it should be elected or nominated. So I think that's our proposition. Thank you.
Thank you. Floor is open. Questions, just pop up your hands and we will give you a microphone. And you can throw your question to Prof. Prof, so your remarks following, yeah.
No, very important. I think the issue of ethnic exclusion is very important.
we don't want to create a system which would, exacerbate ethnic exclusion. So we must take this into account. So that is why we need to craft legislation which will deal with this thing. I think that the first past the post system may be reviewed, and at the local level we may have mixed member proportional representation where you have some people elected and some people based on party lists in order to deal with this ethnic exclusion, because we want to include everybody. And so maybe we may have to look at the way we elect people. Is it the first past the post, or is it proportional representation? Can we have a mixture of proportional representation and direct election, the first past the post? We should look at it. So we need to have modalities. And somebody made a very important point. I think the former local governor, Clock Sack, who made the point that we should have rules and modalities in place. We should create rules and modalities which will help us to usher in a system which will help us. And of course, the Clock Sack years made a very important point that the people should decide. Yes, if you want to, Article 55.3 is an entrenched clause, so it should go through a referendum. So a question will be asked: would you like MMDCs to be elected on party basis or not? That's it. And then they vote on it, and then I think that's a very fair thing to do, yeah.
All right, thanks, Prof. I have a question here. It says, if the elected personality of a particular district belongs to one party and the ruling party is another party, is it possible for them to get all their resources from the ruling party? Would it not disturb that issue? It's a good question, I think.
Yeah, so this is one of the arguments made that Ghana is not ready, that you have an MPP president, and then you have an NDC or PNC chief executive. Would the MPP president release resources? We all know that the District Assembly's Common Fund is not based on parties. It's based on the factors, on the disbursement formula, right? So it will not happen. It's still this fear. People are afraid that, you see, and I know that we Ghanaians, we are usually conservatives. Conservative in the sense that, and it is part of human beings that we don't know what will come. So we know the current system. We don't know the new system. So why can't you stick to the current system? So we need more education. We need the political party should start education. The NCC should also follow up. But then the other thing is that we need a concise agreement from both the MPP and the NDC and the minority parties about this system. And I think that, why not? People have made the point that let us try it. You see, the mere fact that the current system has been tried and it hasn't worked to perfection means that there are problems. So we need to fix those problems through reform.
Thank you. Thank you, Prof. We have a question from the hall. Sir, please, if you could be on your feet for the cameras, introduce yourself and pop your question. Thank you.
Hello. Mohammed Mukhtar is my name. I want to find out, the politician is a professional. The bureaucrat is a professional. So to what extent does the election and the neutrality affect professionalism? Thank you.
Yeah, please, hello. Can you make it more concise, the question again?
I am saying that both workers of the public sector, mm-hmm.
yes.
the politician and the bureaucrat or the administrator, they are both supposed to exhibit professionalism.
Mm-hmm.
To what extent does the election and neutrality affect their professionalization?
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
Okay, so you are talking about the election of MMDCs and then the effect on other professions, that the MMDC may be a professional or the local bureaucrat will be a professional. So how would the elections affect the professionalism of both? Why not? You cannot divorce the fact that when people are elected, they are given certain rights, powers, and responsibilities. And so because of that, because they have been given powers, responsibilities, they have to exercise them based on their professional expertise or based on their expertise. So the elections of MMDs, we are not talking about professionalism here. We are talking about to what extent can we bring everybody on board to promote local development? Because whether we like it or not, the current system has not brought local development. It has not brought inclusion of people. It has not brought, it has not reduced tension. If you look at the violence which actually came as a result of the nomination of the president, etc., etc. So what we are trying to say is that the elections will further deepen professionalism because these two characters or these two individuals have been given certain responsibilities which they have to perform within the rules or the laws. Right?
All right, thank you. Another question here. Okay, the question says, how well have our members of parliament performed? For which reason we should say we should do some more elections?
Well, Honorable Nilate.
Would you like to respond to that?
Okay, I think that whether we like it or not, Parliament has performed. I will not say that it hasn't. You see, when you create institutions, the capacity of the institutions must also be based on what they have done. If you ask them to pass number of laws, number of this, number of that, fine, I don't have any problem. So they have delivered. The only point where they have not delivered is they need more scrutiny. And more scrutiny, you know, can come about if the committees are actually strengthened. I always say that the floor of parliament is just they come there and talk, and then they vote. But the real work, the workshop of parliament at the committee, is the committee system. If the committee system is not working, then of course, forget it. So I would say that parliament has done reasonably well, but within the constraints. But I think we need to deal with those constraints, especially strengthening the committee system. I think the committees will have to do more work. Resources will have to be given to the committees. I know committees which have sat in the lobby of parliament to work. We need to provide more resources and all that so that they can work. So without the committees being strengthened, parliament itself is weak.
Thank you so much. There's a question. Okay, there's a comment. Please, Honorable Ninlante van der Poort.
I know this is a very contestable issue, but I spent days in parliament, and I'm happy our former clerk of parliament is here. Nana Tuata has also been. Sometimes we don't know the work parliament does, and as such, we only talk about what they earn. Yes, you have a legitimate cause when you're a civil servant and look at what you earn, and then you vote for somebody and the person tomorrow is enjoying a V8 and some salary. But the truth of the matter is that sometimes I feel not for even the staff of parliament, the parliamentarians themselves, but the staff. At certain times, this staff of parliament could close around 12 midnight, 1 a.m., 2 a.m. From 10 a.m. in the morning, they could work till 1 a.m. the next day. And then the next morning, they are supposed to be back in parliament. The staff, I'm talking about the civil servants. Agarex, should I have referred to them as civil servants or parliamentary staff? I don't know whether they are within the civil service.
Yes, yes, yes.
They are parliamentary service. So they have their own characteristics. You know. But the truth of the matter is that you talk about strengthening of parliament. In other jurisdictions, that is what makes parliament strong. Then the staff of parliament will be disposed towards spending their time because they are paid well to do the research, to do the reporting, and the rest for the members of parliament to enrich their debate both at the committee level and at the plenary. But when the workers of parliament are paid anything, drivers are being given some 800 cedis, and you expect a driver to drive this MP to some places, horrible roads, come back, go here, there with a, it becomes difficult for him to discharge his duty. The MPs themselves, so that you spend much more of your money to get other people to do work for you than you get. Seriously. Sometimes I sit down and say, what have I earned? Because I was quite better off in GBC than in Parliament. When it comes to responsibilities, because I'm now occupying and taking over people's responsibilities, which normally I wouldn't take when I was at GBC. But the truth of the matter is that if we want Parliament to deliver, they must be given the tools to deliver. You sit down in Parliament and sometimes your internet doesn't even work. You cannot do research. You cannot do anything. You have to go out. So the problems are there. But the truth of the matter is that we are committed to making sure that what we are expected to do, we do. When it comes to this issue, I have now said that we should look at the issue again. I can assure you from our side, we are proactive to the referendum. We are ready to resurrect the debate. We want civil servants, public servants, the civil society organizations to get involved. But then we should not restrict it to only the two political giants, and then our interest will supersede the national interest. This should be led, because at the end of the day, what we are building is for Ghanaian people. So like CROSAC is doing, all these other CSOs must take the lead. And let's decide and say, this is the way the country we want you to go. You are only participant, one of the participants within. But if you leave it to us to champion it and to lead it, definitely our interest will override the national interest. Because I'm a political animal. I want what will always help my party to win. Nana will do the same if he's not already doing. So it is better if we leave it to people to lead. People like Professor Chuayi, this thing you've delivered, like my friend said, if we could replicate it at different fora, the universities, take it up, the churches, take it up, and then we consolidate our views on it. Then we tell the politicians, this is the way we want you to go. These are the ground rules we want you to tally. Other than that, if you leave it to us, we'll always look at how to do the gerrymandering so that even assembly elections, the NDC will win more seats than the MPP. That is my view.
Thank you. So, CROSAC, your job is cut out for you. As part of the neutrality project, you're supposed to take this nationwide. The topic was neutrality in local governance, nonpartisan election of MMDCEs. Professor Joseph Achuaye did a great job. Let's give him a standing ovation. Let's give him a standing ovation. Thank you so very much. Shall we be seated? Yeah, you may please resume your seat. Okay, so this is part one. Part two comes up tomorrow. And tomorrow, various civil and local government officials will be awarded on different fronts, loyalty, integrity, leadership, and other, among other awards. So tomorrow, 10 o'clock sharp,
let's come around. Now, at the end of the program, the dignitaries and chief directors kindly use this door, and the rest of us will stay here. You'll be taken care of. You'll be sorted, so to speak. Let's take our closing prayer from Pastor Bayo. Please join us here.
Shall we please rise to our feet? You agree with me that it's been really thought-provoking and very insightful. And it has been by God's help. We want to thank him and give him all the praise. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. The remaining part of the day is blessed in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Hi. Hey, government, don't take it back. The civil servant.
Please kindly be seated. Lunch will be served in a minute, please.
Then you can start to make Ghana better. Hey, government, don't take it bad. Take the civil servants and make them better. Remember to partner civil servants, then you can start to make Ghana better. Hey, government, don't be afraid. We are behind you in whatever you do. Remember to partner civil servants, then you can start to make Ghana better. Anytime you hear us cry, a government refrain, and listen to all that we are saying. Don't you know we need your help to hold our hands and carry us high upon your shoulders? Na 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 na. Hey, government, don't let us down. You have had us, now go and help us. Remember to partner civil servants, then you can start to make Ghana better, 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 better. Ah.
Whisper words of wisdom. Let
Klosak has taken up this issue.
Hello, hello,
as
hello.
His fourth public lecture. I hope that as we discuss, as we debate the issues, I'm sure the people of Ghana will become clearer. We elect or not we elect MMDCs based on multi-party democracy.
So, sir, can you give us your summary about this subject of neutrality in local governance, non-partisan election of MMDCs?
Yes, as I said, neutrality itself is a much contested term, contested in the light of the fact that the civil and local government, you know, servant work within highly intense political environment. How do they navigate this whole environment? As I said, neutrality is a question of degree. So the civil and local government, you know, servant should try as much as possible to have a degree of neutrality, particularly administrative neutrality. As for political neutrality, yes, can still do that, but then of course, given the highly political environment and even the choices that the civil and local government, you know, servant himself will make, that's why, you know, sometimes political neutrality is compromised. But I believe that as we educate people about neutrality, in Taiwan, for instance, a program is organized annually to sensitize civil servants, local government, you know, service staff on administrative neutrality. So I believe that as time goes on, the civil and local government, the service staff association itself should organize more courses on neutrality to enable its officials to be more sensitized to issues around neutrality.
Thank you, sir. It's great having you today.
Thanks a lot.
All right. So moving forward, it's great, and you can take your leave.
Okay.
It's a pleasure once again from the Professor Joseph Achu Aye, who gave us the public lecture today as part of the ceremony this year, has given us his word. And the take home we can emphasize on his concern of modalities being put in place to sensitize the public and officials on the need for neutrality. And we'll be having an award ceremony, God willing, tomorrow here, same place at the Nathan Anankwa Auditorium here at the Klosak National Secretariat. We look forward to you joining online, Klosak Facebook, and also Klosak HQ via YouTube. Meanwhile, we'll be awaiting to have engagement with other officials as and when they grant us permission to. Stay tuned.
The leading dollar digital currency joins the Tron ecosystem, going live.
this, the Supreme Court gave a ruling that no civil servant, only civil servant, both at the central levels and the decentralized level, can be an assemblyman while still being a civil servant. If you want an assemblyman, you must resign. You can contest, but immediately you win, and before you are sworn, you must resign. And the ruling said, assemblymen, we are aware that we have the elected and an appointed. So definitely it covers the appointment. And we are all aware that government has been appointed 30% of assemblymen to the assemblies. And some of them are civil servants. So we are bringing government's attention to the fact that this category of assembly members they've appointed are not supposed to be assembly members, or they have to resign. So we are advising those who are into those categories to either resign or they have to be disciplined. And government should know that it's a contempt of the Supreme Court ruling, and therefore they must be advised. We are aware that certain civil servants have been appointed as assemblymen, which we have advised them that if you want to be an assemblyman, then resign, whether elective or appointed. The ruling covers all. So if you want to be an assemblyman, please resign and leave those of us who want to be civil servants to be civil servants. And we are aware government are the ones that appointed them. So we are advising government to obey the Supreme Court ruling, or else we will have to go back. Thank you.
Director Parliamentary Affairs and happens to be the chairperson for CLOCSAG Planning Committee. Welcome, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much.
It's a pleasure to have you once again.
It's a pleasure to be here.
All right.
It's exciting.
Great. Can you share with us your take on the public lecture today?
Thank you very much for the opportunity. We couldn't have selected a better person to deliver this subject matter. The lecturer has done justice to the issues. If you look at local governance, I have said that everywhere, every development is a local development. And local development is national development. If we are able to harmonize relationships at the local level and bring development to that local level, then cumulatively we'll be developing the country. But what has become a vast issue is the issue of the assemblies, whether it is partisan, non-partisan, whether MMDCEs should be elected, and even if they should be elected, should they be elected on a partisan basis, among others. This is a vexed issue. And don't forget that since 1988, we've been practicing this system. And if we have found problems with the system, why don't we go back and reorganize, revamp, rejuvenate, reorient the system through some serious, deliberate intervention through reforms. That is what it is that we need to look at. And for me, if we have a superstructure which is highly partisan, built on a structure which is non-partisan, it's contradictory in terms. That is why it is important that we revisit the issues. I mean, politics is ubiquitous. Politics is everywhere. What is important is that how do we put into the governance system a set of checks and balances, such that even when people are elected, they will still be responsive enough to address the critical needs of society. We are seeking to build countervailing forces into the governance system so that we it's like ambition should be made to counteract ambition. And one way of making sure that ambition will counteract ambition is to make sure that leaders at some level have some principles of accountability. And that is where people are saying that then they will need to be elected among others, etc. It is important that this conversation should continue. Let us harvest ideas from all the key stakeholders, not just the political actors, but all of us should be interested. in how these ideas are harvested. And then at the end of the day, we'll have some, we'll build some consensus on the way to go, to making sure that we'll strengthen the assemblies in a manner that will let them have the capacity to actually lead the development that we so diligently seek. That's my position.
All right, that's great and insightful. Thanks for coming. Yeah,
thank you very much for the opportunity.
Okay, so as earlier said, I've been with Dr. Agu, who happens to be the chairperson for CLOCSAC Plan Committee, as well as the chief director, Parliamentary Affairs. And it's been a successful event today, marking the first day of the two-day Nathan Anankwal Awards Ceremony 2021. Today marks the public lecture, and gracefully we are done. And it will be climaxed with awards ceremony tomorrow here at the National Secretariat, CLOCSAC. And it seeks to honor CLOCSAC members who have over the years displayed some level of neutrality and loyalty, integrity, professionalism, leadership, among others. And it's an honor to encourage other teams who will not be awarded, and as well entreat and motivate awardees among their servants as a whole. You've been watching TV with me, and tuned.
I've been held in your hand from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. I will sing of the goodness of God.